Welcome back, Cinema Appreciation. I hope all of you are doing well. Today we'll be talking about realism, classicism, and formalism, the basic kind of underlying principles on how we make a film and think about making a film, and then later on how we're going to edit the film as well. Now, this is not to be confused with film genre, where we talk about horror, romantic comedy, drama, science fiction. This is really a much broader range that we look at it. For those of you who missed our first class last week, please note also that there is an MP4 file under lecture notes under week one to go back and look and actually see the material we went over, specifically the idea of different things that actually show up within the syllabus. So if you have not already watched that video, by all means, go back and make sure you have a good overview of how class entails so you don't have to cover it more than once in class. I hope everything is going well, and let's be off. When we look at styles and types or modes of filmmaking, we basically, and in your video or in your notes, you'll see this lovely chart from your book. It basically establishes we go from realism all the way to formalism. So realism, as you can imagine, is the stuff that is real and tends towards the documentary style. Formalism is that experimental side. It has the idea with a lot of editing and formal kind of content, and later on will be really the avant-garde kind of art experiential movements that show up. Right in the middle then is classicism. And classicism is the Hollywood style of making films, largely for an entertainment function, but there are almost always different variations of stories. So even when a realist film starts to tell a story, as it shies a little bit away from documentary to tell that story, for example, historical narration, or based upon reality without a lot of fact-checking behind it, we move more and more to classicism. So almost all films that you know basically somewhere in this central range that show up. Note, there are two stops between classicism and formalism or avant-garde films. One of them we'll talk about later on is expressionism. That's kind of dark, gothic themes, very angular kind of components. We don't see it all that very often. It started in Germany in the 1920s. Our most common individual that does it, at least in some styles of his films, is Tim Burton. And the other image right underneath it, not to be confused, is auteur, which is a little bit past classicism on its way to formalism, but much more in the classical side over here. And that is largely, auteur means author. That's where you have a director who, when you watch his films, you very much know what you're looking at. So for example, if you watch a Tim Burton film, you know you're looking at an expressionist type filmmaker. If you see a Quentin Tarantino film, you absolutely know the different features that you're gonna see in a Quentin Tarantino film, particularly for those of you who are fans. And they almost always are just a little bit right of this classicism that shows up, as we'll talk about later. So realism and formalism are really the two ends of the poles. And when we talk about film realism, there's no better place to start than your weekly reading and video that actually dealt with the Lumiere brothers. Lumiere brothers, specifically the Arrival of a Train, kind of the birthing of the film industry as we know it for public consumption. Basically, the more real a film is, the more it records reality without changing it. And so the best affect of way of looking at a realist film is basically a still camera that stays locked in place with no editing. That's a true realist film, and very seldom do we have those. Our first formalist film you also watched this week, and we'll talk about this more in class today, from the Méliès, and its idea of the tendencies to recreate reality or presenting a new different reality, like we see in our lovely Star Wars ship behind me, with Millennium Falcon with me driving with my good friend Chewie over here, and girl I had a crush on for many years, for just laying in the back. I was a small child when the original series came out. So when we talk about realism, what features would you expect to see in a realist film? What do you think would be the tendencies of something that is closer and closer to realism? So our realism characteristics are very good. They're over here. We're going to have long takes, not a lot of moving camera. We're going to have cutting to continuity. If you don't know what that means basically we're only going to cut to try to shorten down the time without altering or changing the story at all. For example, if you want to see a documentary film about an individual that is struggling against the coal mine, we don't need to see the person sleep for 6 hours. So we're going to cut those 6 hours. We're going to see the teeth brushing, lying down in the bed, and then we're going to go to him waking up in the morning at 6 or 7 to go to the coal mine. We don't need to watch him sleep as they did in the Truman Show. So we're going to cut out those unnecessary details that don't involve the plot or change the plot. That's called cutting for continuity or cutting to continuity. We're going to have moving camera shots. When we do, it's almost always going to be a handheld camera that follows them around, because in many cases, we won't know where and when events are going to take place. They're just happening before us. We're going to have long and medium shots farther away so we can actually see the contextual framework that's going around. We're going to have a lot of straight angles, and that means an angle that's at eye level. So we're going to have this equality, so we're not making value judgments within it. We're going to have a normal lens with not a lot of widescreen or wide angle lenses or telephoto lenses. That way we get the idea of always being there. It's going to be unobtrusive. We're going to try not to involve ourselves in the action at all. There's going to be natural lighting in most cases. And that natural lighting might even be interior lighting that we actually have to go in or out of, depending on, are we in the coal mine? Are we out of doors? We're going to have natural sound and ambient sounds just in the background. So we're filming our individual, so we don't have a closed set. We're going to have the natural colors that happen to be, or the natural colors that happen to be in that particular situation. It's going to be an open form. And when we talk about open form versus closed form, an open form is the idea that you will not need to know, a lot of information about the events or the ideas that are coming into it beforehand, because everything is going to be explained and given to you within the context of the film itself. It's more of a documentary, more realist style. And so if we need to tell you anything about the coal mine, we'll give you a little bit of information at the beginning, but otherwise, people through interviews, through watching them, you're going to get all the information that you need to make a rational decision or an emotional decision. And finally, we're going to have a sense of spontaneity. You may even hear people go, oh, on camera because they were surprised that something just happened, because it wasn't always planned out beforehand. So as you think through this, think about Arrival on a Train, a little over a minute video here by the Lumiere brothers, specifically that deals with, as you can imagine, realism. Note there's no sound, it's natural lighting, there's no professional actors. When people first saw this, it was so shocking. They actually ran out of the theater because they thought the train was actually going to hit them, even without the sound. They had never seen film like this. And so they just assumed it's supposed to be a real train. Your eyes have to be trained to see film and to see images that are coming at you. We don't really have great images for motion. Note we have an exactly steady cam. If we are going to follow anyone, we're going to have to pick it up and actually follow them around, which means that also people are going to be getting in and out of our line of sight as we're watching the particular scene that shows up. And that's all Arrival of a Train is, our first true documentary and a very realist film with almost no cutting at all. So what features would you expect to see in a formalist film? We're going to have very frequent cuts. We're going to edit a lot. We're going to cutting for dramatic effect, and also to carry our story along, even if we have to eliminate some details. We're gonna do this concept called thematic montage, where we're gonna cut one image next to another image to make relationships or allow the audience to make their own relationships. We're gonna do movement through different versions of camera and montage. Montage means it's from the French word to assemble. So we're going to assemble a different shot together. We're gonna have a lot more close-ups, so we can get kind of the emotional reactions of the films as much as we possibly can, but also because we can set the shot up and change the angles, it's way easier to get close-ups to make sure the lighting is consistent. We are going to use more telephoto and wide-angle effects. We have the opportunity because we're helping to plan the film out, and that's going to be the same thing with dynamic effects, with special effects. We're going to have more sculptured lighting than we have in natural lighting, so we can choose, do we want it to be dark and morose, and more along a horror film or a film noir with very dark low-key lighting? Do you want high-key lighting, like in a romantic comedy or in just a regular comedy? We have that the option. We are gonna have studio settings. We can actually have completely created settings. They don't all have to be what's just in front of us as in a documentary film. We're gonna get to control the sound, so any ambient noise that's off screen, we're gonna eliminate. We're going to use intense symbolic colors if we want to and when we want to for anything, whether that is for the main character coming in. And these are largely going to be closed form, which means we're going to have to give you information about what is going on so that you understand the plot, you understand the characters. For example, when we start off on Star Wars, the exposition, the beginning of that closed form says, long, long ago in a galaxy far away, and then the music comes on and gives you the information that you need to know to understand the plot. Most films, we're going to have some aspect of exposition that comes out in that closed form, because it's not just something that's happening in every day that we know of. It's a set up environment that transports us to another world, and we need to know more about that other world. So one of the most famous formalist films of all time is this particular film here, Journey to the Moon by the Méliès. And as we look at this, I want you to think about a couple of things. Number one, this is a formalist film. So what features of formalism are you going to see here?
I shot myself out.
From Journey to the Moon. So what films of formalist films are you going to see as I walk through it? And the other, also consider the idea that this is, while it is a formalist film back then, because it challenges the nature of what reality with all the editing and coloration, various camera movements, special effects that are going to come up for the first time in this film. At the same time today, this would actually be a storyline film that's classical. So because later on, we're going to invent more formalist types of film. But this is the first one that develops any type of action. And look how early and how fantastic this film is from 1902. So whenever color is added, color literally has to be hand-drawn on 24 frames per second. So you'll notice when there's color, sometimes you see a slight color variation between 1 second and the next. That is probably because there's more than one color variation, or the color just changed ever so slightly for that fraction of a second that changed it. Now, everything about that you're about to see is made up. No one had been to space. We're 60 years away from space exploration. No one really was even starting to think about going into space. We did not have the technology. We're not quite there yet. So you can see it's almost like space travel brought to you by the wizards from Hogwarts. I will also mention that besides the coloration and the birth of some special effects, note, we still have a long take. This is very early on, and we haven't cut to another scene yet. There will be some cutting coming up in the near future. Also note that actually silent films such as this were never really silent. Silent films always had a musical score and generally a live band or orchestra that played in the orchestra. So if you ever go to a very fancy older theater, you'll generally see an area right in front, right before the first seats where the musicians would sit and play. We see early on the cutting to continuity in terms of all the information that you need. Later on, when we learn more about filmmaking and how the visual medium works, we would cut this down to about 30 seconds rather than it being 3 minutes of coming in with all the different events and variations. This could easily be cut to continuity for the most important parts in a much shorter format. But again, this, the language of film is first being invented in 1902. There's our first dissolve, one of our first editing techniques we ever make to go from one image to the next. And they're in the process of making their rocket ship. We see the workers. Now, of course, we do not make rocket ships anything like that. Even pounding on the anvil in the left-hand corner, that is not actually how you make metal, even back then, right? We've poured metal to make these shapes. So part of it is just fun and acting. And these are not professional actors. we're going to develop professional actors and get them on film later on. This film was a huge success of hit, though, when it came out in France. People wanted to see the film over and over again. Our first use of special effects right here. Note the back with that smoke, that's real smoke. So the back half, that background, is actually a real background that's been hand-painted and colored. The front is also a real foreground with the paint. So it's two or three different shots that are put together 24 times every second to make sure that they all blend together seamlessly. We're going to see that a couple different times. Here we have women in the early 1900s seeing them off, standing on top of the roofline of a house. You see a couple edits right there. They wanted to continue a long shot, but for some reason, something didn't work in the shot. So they just eliminated and tried to jump as close as they possibly could to the next shot. So we are starting developing the idea of editing here to tell a narrative story. So even though, as I mentioned before, this is our first formalist film, that's challenging because it's edited. It's very different than our realist film. By today's standards, by far, this is just a classical Hollywood trying to tell a story type film. So the first formalist film actually wasn't formalist enough to be formalist today. I'll show you one of those films later on today. Or a clip of it. No scientific evidence or anything, but we're going to push the rocket capsule into the giant cannon. Another dissolve. And now we are finally going to launch them to the moon. And note, that cannon better be accurate because it's going hundreds of thousands of miles away and it's got to hit it perfectly. Now, one of the most famous scenes in all of film, you've all seen this scene before because we reference it all the time. Here's the man in the moon coming out. If you've been to Imagination at Walt Disney World, John Cleese plays that, and he gets hit right in the eye in the Figment ride. And look how we depict the moon. Nothing like what the moon is. No one knew. We didn't have high-powered telescopes enough to really understand the topography yet. Note they also don't need spacesuits or any protective cold clothing. We don't know space is really cold yet. Well, they do have a consideration and they do get it right that it's going to be cold. You'll see they're going to do some science fiction. Here's the lovely Earth rising over the moon, the first time anyone had ever seen it, supposedly. I say supposedly because later on there's going to be creatures on the moon. Those are all hand-drawn vents coming up as fire vents, showing the dangers there are and why these men coming back, these elder scientists, are going to be treated as heroes if they make it back to the world. And they decide after a long trip, it's time to take a nap. And you'll note it starts snowing, it's nighttime, so it is still cold there. That's Halley's Comet coming across. First time it ever shown up. And of course the stars, which will largely be named after female celestial beings, will come out, kind of sing them to sleep because they're so close to the stars now. I'm going to skip back just a minute or so, because after they take their nap and they get their sleep, they're going to be visited . Note they're going to descend down into one of the caverns. And note how different the topography is underneath than it is above. Right? Maybe the moon is made out of Swiss cheese and these are the holes, which was a thought earlier on, that you could go down into the moon. And look, we basically enter into a prehistoric dinosaur world. Right? That's like underneath the sea. Now it's all exciting. Flowing water, plants, magical features. Note the first science fiction, the umbrella actually becomes this mushroom that's growing. Ooh, and look, there's alien creatures now. So our first depiction of film and ever of alien. And note they're fairly menacing. And all you have to do is tap them with an umbrella and they disappear. Note the beautiful hand-drawn colors, though, of the smoke as they disappear. All that had to be hand-drawn. Uh-oh, there's a whole bunch of them. So they're led to the king of the moon. These very beautifully costumed individuals, right, creating an otherworldly face. Of course, they're surrounded by beautiful star celestial women that are Earth-like. And so one of them breaks free. Look, and he's upset. And he's going to kill the Moon King. Now they've got to run away. So will they make it off the moon into back to the world? And if so, how? Will science help them? You know, just hitting them in the chest with an umbrella is enough to take them to the gaseous state again. So the best way that we know to actually get back to Earth, I guess reverse gravity from the moon. And that they're just going to fall downward like it's above us. And eventually they're going to land in a very cartoon animation way, which actually became the model in some capacity for the Monty Python. You know, it floats back, but look how unusual the creatures are underneath the water too. We hadn't started exploring in submarines yet. So that information would all be new too. And they're gonna get dragged back as heroes. My favorite part of this scene is, no, rather than being on the boat, they're actually still sitting on top of their rocket. Coming back into town, they're gonna be scientists of the year, of the century, celebrated with bands. And of course, celebrating their rocket ship like we do. And so this is what the very earliest of the formalist films looked like. And so what formalist features do you see? All right, we're going to see editing, we're going to see coloration, we're going to see dissolves, we're going to see a narrative plot line and some energy that shows up that's radically different, which will eventually move into classical. We're seeing a lot of these features starting to show up, including multiple cameras. And look, they did actually, there was one on top that ended up making it here, so now we have an alien to explore. So when we look at film theory then, the difference between what we call early formalism and early realism basically comes to this. How will the audience understand my story? The realism basically says I'm honest. Standard shots, straightforward editing, eye level, get close, let us see the action, let the script do the talking, draw us in with a steady image. The formalist, crazy shots, wild editing, high and low angles, vary the distance, show us what they want to see and surprise us with a new perspective, right? That's the alien showing up. Movement makes us nervous and excited. And that really is the foundational difference between the two. And so, as I mentioned before, Journey to the Moon was absolutely seen in this capacity all the way out here in the formalist action. Today, though, if we were to move it over, it's just like Planet of the Apes. It really would be in the classical section. And that is because when we look at formalism, note the features that show up. And I'll run through these quickly. Frequent cuts, cutting for drama, thematic montage, montage, or movement through montage, close-up, strong angles, dynamic effects. It literally becomes about motion and energy, particularly of different objects. So by today's standard, this is what we would consider formalism. So this is a film from the 1930s. This is Footlight Parade, as you can see up here. It's done by an artist named Busby Berkeley, who basically invented the modern day and piloted the modern day musical that we have that leads to Disney musical and other individuals that show up. But basically, they're going to use the human body then to form different energy and movement, not necessarily to get the plot across. And oftentimes, it's women in bikinis that are actually making these beautiful images. If you were on the great movie ride ever before it closed, you'll notice they had a number of his performances playing there by Busby Berkeley, though you're on the bottom. One of the great early directors for music. But see how it's not narrative. It really kind of gets an emotional sense, or it's a stimulation to the way you think and move, not necessarily about a narration. So it's all about this movement and this energy. Just look how cool some of the sets are, how they rotate around one another. It's all about motion and kinetics. So we found this idea that it's really about the motion and the kinetics that show up. The other film that I want to show you, at least a brief clip of, is the idea of what we look at when we look at expressionism. This is going to be The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari up here, as you can see, by Robert Wiener. And this is actually going to be an expressionist artwork. This is going to be sets with jagged, stylized shapes and harsh, unnatural colors used to convey emotions. It is a storyline, so it's closer to the classical canon, but to classical line using a particular style, almost auteur theory, which we'll talk about more, about the author and the stylistic features. Using that jagged style, sharp, harsh light, it's rejection of naturalistic acting, which distorts reality. They're gonna have darker themes. Beliefs and ideas of the filmmaker are very apparent, and this is one of the films that does lead us on later on to auteur theory as we're talking about it. And so here it is. Basically a birth of the horror film coming out of German expressionist film in the 1920s in World War I and World War II. And you'll see there's a lot of references for Hollywood later on in terms of chase scenes and horror scenes and darkness and even the music being discordant. There we go. We basically get a combination of the mummy, Frankenstein, and the vampire in these very highly lit kind of events. Note the radical darkness behind them. Note almost every scene has angles and things that don't match up, that are reaching off to one area or another of the film screen. Look at the diagonals for no apparent reason, except to add that aspect of jagged culture to it, when that really is a representation of a door that they can go through. See the angles behind her even there. So this is what we call expressionist filmmaking. It does have a storyline, So it's more in the middle range of classicism, but it's a little off of classicism because it's a stylized design. Look at the angles of the roof they show here. And really that kind of gothic horror. Really, Tim Burton is going to be the individual that picks up on this in modern day Hollywood. Here we see kind of a combination vampire Frankenstein that the doctor is working on. So early Hollywood films are going to be based, particularly horror films, are going to be based upon this style. And so let's see if you can name what film styles these are. Your choices are realism, classicism, formalism, or expressionism right now. This is one of the great film trailers of all time for the movie Alien. 1979, the first science fiction horror crossover genre that establishes the genre that we so often have today. And this is one of the films that's on your top 100 list. Always, as I should mention, as Arrival of Train was, as Dr. Caligari was, and as the Lumiere Brothers' Arrival of a Train was. Note, the discordant music probably tells us it's not realism. Maybe it's formalism, we haven't seen enough yet. But now as we start to see a storyline develop, that gives us kind of a horror story, we realize, all right, we've got to be more in the classical frame. So now we have to ask the question, are we in classical frame, or is this actually expressionism? And that really is the challenge then when we look at these two films. It's got the goth, it's got the darkness, but it doesn't have a lot of the angularity that shows up within that. So we're probably looking at a classical style film, even though it's a horror film. And that's exactly what it is. What about this film style? You probably all know the film, Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas. All right, we already know it's not realism. We're starting to introduce characters. We've got Halloween, so it's not just about energy and movement. So we know it cannot be the idea of the other end of formalism. So again, we're down to classicism versus expressionism. And here you start looking at the gothic nature. Look at all the angles on the cutting edge. This is going to be a pretty close to expressionist class. Look at the angles there. What about this film? All right, it's not representing anything, so we probably don't have documentary or realism. Doesn't appear to have a narration, so it's not classicism. So that would move this isn't the avant-garde, the new style of formalism. This is what formalism looks like today. Objects kind of out of character, out of place, show motion, kinetics, energy, and that's what we're looking at. And so we put it right in the middle of realism and classicism here, and that's what we're looking at. That's how you analyze the different film genres. I hope everything is well. Go well. Bye.